now, right here, 1977. We have some of the most cutting-edge lights and sound here in the studio. Coming up next, we even have a brand new cassette tape with a theme song. But before we proceed, we need to lay down our studio rules. As it's allowed for the three episodes, there's going to be a 10-minute intermission between episodes 1 and 2. During those intermissions is when you can leave the auditorium. But we please ask you guys stay in your seats during the episodes. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy the live viewing of the Importance of Being Earnest.
Almost as bad as the way she flirts with you. To propose? I thought you said you came for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are, Algie.
There's no use in debating it. There's absolutely nothing romantic in a proposal. To be in love? Sure. But a proposal? I mean, you might get accepted. One usually is. And then the excitement's all over. The very essence of romance is uncertainty. Something if I'm ever married, I'm going to be really happy to forget.
Preach it.
I have no doubt about that fact, my dear Algie. The divorce courts were made specifically for people whose minds are so curiously constituted.
Divorces are made in heaven. Please, don't just pick up my sandwiches. Thank you. They were made specifically for Aunt Augusta.
You have been eating them this entire time.
She's my aunt. Would you have some bread and butter? Bread and butter's for my one. She loves bread and butter.
And what good bread and butter is, too.
You don't need to eat it all greedily. It's not like you're already married to her. I find that really unlikely in the first place.
And why is that?
Never marry the men before. They don't think it's right.
That's ridiculous!
It is not. It explains the extraordinary number of bachelors you see wandering around the city on a daily basis. In the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
Of course. She's my first cousin. Before I lie to go and marry her, do I have to put the whole situation with Cecily?
Cecily? Algie, I don't know what you're talking about with Cecily. I don't know who this Cecily person is that you speak of.
Like, could you bring me the cigarette case for Ernest last Thursday?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Do you need to tell me that you have had my cigarette case this entire time? I wish to goodness you had told me. I've been looking for it everywhere. I've been writing frantic letters to the police and, well, I almost got put up on the ward.
You can still offer it.
There's no point offering a reward now that the thing is found.
I think that's rather mean, Marcus. Thank you. Like, actually, now that I'm looking at it, it doesn't appear to be yours after all.
Algie, what are you talking about? Of course the thing is mine. You've seen me with it a thousand times. You have no right whatsoever to look at what's inside. It's a very ungentlemanly thing to look inside of a private cigarette case.
You can't tell me what I should look at and what I shouldn't look at. Half of modern culture is made up of what one shouldn't look at.
I don't mean to discuss modern culture with you. That isn't the sort of thing that people should discuss in private. Give me my cigarette case.
But you said you didn't know anyone by the name of Cecily. This is from someone named Cecily. From little Cecily, but they're fond of separation.
If you must know, Cecily is my aunt.
Aunt?
Yes, charming lady she is too. Lives in a home upstate. Now just give me my cigarette case.
Well, if your aunt who lives in a charming home upstate, why then does she call herself little Cecily?
My friend, what is there in that? Some aunts are tall. Some aunts are not tall. Surely that is a matter that any aunt can decide for herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be like your own. And that, my friend, is absurd. Now just give me my cigarette case.
I'll admit it, that an aunt can decide how tall or short she wants to be. That seems perfectly reasonable. But why an aunt? Whatever her size would be. Call her own nephew, her uncle. Just can't quite figure out. But look, from little Cecily with her fondest admiration to her dear Uncle Jack. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all, it's Ernest.
It isn't Ernest, it's Jack.
That's ridiculous. I've known you as Ernest my whole life. You've introduced yourself to everyone's Ernest. I've introduced you to Gwendolyn's Ernest. I've introduced you to Aunt Augusta's Ernest, too. You're the most Ernest-looking person I have ever to tell me your name isn't Ernest, or tell one of anyone else.
My name is Ernest in town, and Jack in the country. That cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Okay. Still doesn't explain why she calls you Uncle Jack.
My dear friend, you talk as though you were a dentist. It's very vulgar to talk as a dentist when one is not a dentist. It leaves a false impression.
Yeah. Ernest, that's exactly what they did. Come on, show me the whole story. Be out with it, Laura. You can jack in the country and Ernest sit down. And before you begin, I might say I've always suspected you of being a bun brace, and I'm quite certain of it.
What's a bun brace?
I'll tell you once you tell me your whole story.
Cigarette case first, or
pray make the story improbable.
There's nothing improbable about my story at all. In fact, it's quite ordinary. The old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a young boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew, who currently lives in my country house, and out of motives of respect that you could not possibly understand, calls me her uncle. She currently lives in my country house under the charge of the admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Just out of curiosity, where is this house?
That is nothing to you. You will not be invited. I may tell you candidly that the place is not in plain sight.
Suspected as much. I myself have unmarried all over the place, two separate occasions. Now go on, continue your story. Why are you jacking the country and first in town?
I don't think you would be able to understand why. Heart is serious enough. When one is placed in the position of a guardian, one has to adopt a very high moral tone. And a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce with either one's health or one's happiness. So to get up to town, I have pretended to have a younger brother by the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany and gets into the most terrible situations. That, my friend, is the whole truth, pure and simple.
The truth, pure and simple. Ernest, the truth is rarely pure and never simple. You're a bun brace. One of the best bun braces I've ever seen.
What is a bun brace?
That's quite easy. Quite simple, really. You see, you created, as you say, the younger brother by the name of Ernest. City whenever you please. And I've created a very helpful friend by the name of Mr. Bunbury, so that I may escape the country whenever I please. Bunbury is perfectly invalid, and he's perfect anyway. Without him, I wouldn't be able to dine with Bill Wilson tonight. I've been told to go to dinner with Dr. Gustin.
I haven't asked for you to dine with me anywhere tonight.
I know. You should be more careful when you send out invitations. Some bed can offend it.
You had better dine with your Aunt Augusta.
I will do nothing of the sort. First of all, I already dined with her on Monday, and once a week is plenty to my family. Secondly, whenever I go over there, they treat me like family. They either sit me down with no women or two women. Thirdly, I know exactly where I'm going to be sitting. I'm going to be sitting next to this Mary Buffalo. Who worked with her own husband across the dinner table. Do you know how annoying that is? No, do you know how disgusting that is? The flirt with your own husband, and that kind of thing is absolutely on the rise. I see women walking around in broad daylight flirting with their husbands. You might as well wash your underwear clean in the streets. Besides, now that I know you're a bunburyist, I want to tell you the rules.
I'm not a bunburyist at all. If Gwendolyn accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. In fact, I think I'm going to kill him anyway. Cecily is a little too invested in it, and it's really rather bored. I suggest that you do the same with your Mr. the invalid friend with the ridiculous name, Bunberry. His name is Bunberry.
And I will do nothing of the sort. To know Bunbury too, if you ever get married, which I find highly unlikely. Someone who doesn't know Bunbury when they're married, it's a very difficult time of it.
If I
myself to never bring that up. If I can get out of the room for 10 minutes, enough time for you to propose to Gwendolyn, I'm dining with your Wilsons.
Fine, if you want.
Gotta be serious about it. I hate when people aren't serious about their meals. It's so shallow of them.
Of course.
charming weather it has been, Miss Fairfax.
Please don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthy. Whenever someone talks to me about the weather, I often feel quite nervous because I know that they mean something else.
Well, I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I know.
I would like to be able to take advantage of your mother's temporary absence.
I would encourage you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back to the room so suddenly. I've often wanted to be very happy.
Gwendolyn, ever since the day that I met you, I have admired you more than any girl that I have ever met since the day that I met you.
Yeah, I'm quite aware of that fact. And in public and angry, I wish you had been more selfish. When I first met you, I knew I was a different company. We live, Mr. Williams, in an age of ideals. The fact is constantly mentioned in more expensive monthly magazines and series of coverage of pulpits are told. And my ideal to always be to marry someone with the name of Ernest, the name of someone's absolute confidence. The woman out of office meant to be here for me, Ernest. I knew I was destined to love you.
You really love me, one of them?
Passionately.
Oh, darling, you don't know how happy you've made me. But you don't mean to say that you couldn't love me if my name weren't Ernest.
But your name is.
I know, but supposing that it was something else, could you love me then?
That is clearly a metaphysical speculation. And just like most metaphysical speculations, they show very little evidence of the actual real facts of life. The only real safe name is Ernest.
To speak quite candidly, darling, I don't really much care for the name of Ernest. I don't think that it really suits me.
Oh, but it suits you perfectly. It's defining. It produces vibration.
I really think that there are much nicer names out there. Like, for instance, is a charming name.
Jack? No. There's very little music in my name, Jack, any at all. I know several Jacks, and they all, without a doubt, have been more than usually plain. Besides, Jackson's glorious nickname for the name John, and I pity any woman married to a man named John. She probably would never know a single moment's solitude of life's entrancing pleasures.
You must get christened at once. I mean, we must get married at once. There's no time to be lost.
Mary, Ernest.
Well, surely you know that I love you. What you led me to believe weren't exactly indifferent to me.
We haven't even talked about marriage. The subject hasn't been touched upon.
Can I propose now?
I think that'd be an admirable opportunity. And it's safe that we can spare and believe this service is accepted.
Gwendolyn?
Yes, Mr. Reddy, what do you have to say?
I know what I have to say to you.
Yeah, but why didn't say it?
Gwendolyn, I have never loved anyone in the world but you.
Yeah, but men often propose for practice. I know my brother Gerald does, all my girlfriends sons. Oh, Ernest, what wonderful blue eyes you have.
They were quite blue.
Those eyes flushing when other people look at them.
spoken.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that. A man should always have an occupation of some kind.
There are far too many idle men in Philadelphia as it is.
Not for me, sir. How old are you?
29.
Very good age to be married at. I have always been under the impression that a young man who desires to get married should either know everything or nothing. Which do you know, Mr. Worthing?
I know nothing, Mrs. Bracken.
That pleases me. I do not approve of anything that tampers with natural ignorance. Ignorance is like a delicate exotic fruit. Touch it, and the bloom is gone. The whole theory with modern education is radically unsound. Fortunately, in Philadelphia, education produces no effect whatsoever. If it did, it would probably prove a serious danger to the upper classes. Probably lead to acts of violence in Times Square. What is your income?
Around 11 to 12,000 a year.
In land or in investments?
In investments, chiefly.
That sounds not unsatisfactory. What with the duties expected of one during one's lifetime and the duties exacted over one after one's death, land has ceased to be either a profit or a pleasure. And that's all that could really be said about land.
I do have a country house with some land attached to it, of course, around 1,500 acres, but, well, I don't use it for my real income. As far as I can make out, the only people who can really get anything out of it are the poachers.
A country house, you say? How many bedrooms? Oh, that matter can be cleared up later. It is a town home, I hope. A girl brought up with a simple, unspoiled nature like Gwendolyn could hardly be expected to reside in luxury.
I do have a townhouse in Belgrave Square, but it's let out by the year to Mrs. Bloxham. I can get it back at 6 months' notice, though.
Mrs. Bloxham? I have never heard of her.
She really doesn't get out much. She's a lady very considerably advanced in years.
Nowadays, that gives no guarantee of respectability or character. What number is Belgrave Square?
149.
Ugh, the unfashionable side. I thought there was something. However, that could be easily altered.
The fashion or the size?
Both, if necessary, I presume. What are your politics?
I'm afraid that I really have none. I'm a unionist.
Oh, they count as conservatives. They dine with us, or come in the evening, at any rate. Now, on to minor matters. Are your parents living?
I'm afraid that I have lost both of my parents.
Both, Mr. Worthing? To lose one parent may be regarded as a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who was your father? He was evidently a man of some wealth. Was he born in what the papers call new money?
Or did it come from abroad?
Well, the thing is that I don't really know, Mrs. Bracknell. I said that I had lost both of my parents, but it would be nearer to the truth to say that they lost me. I was found.
Found?
Yeah, the late Mr. Thomas Cardew, a man of a very charitable and kindly disposition, found me and gave me the name of Worthing because, well, he had a first-class ticket to Worthing in his pocket at the time. Worthing is a place in Jersey. It's a seaside resort.
And, where did this charitable gentleman who had a first-class ticket to this seaside resort find it?
In a handbag.
In a handbag?
Congratulations, man.
How'd it go? Cheers.
Women never call each other that until they call each other a lot of other things first. to the, go to the theater. I hate to look at things. Go to the bar.
I hate listening.
Okay, we can go for a walk in the park. Okay.
You mean to say you want me to talk to people? That's just so silly.
What are we supposed to do?
Absolutely nothing.
Nothing? Nothing's awfully hard work, Ernest.
Jack.
Well, I'm not really opposed to hard work when there's no definite object in mind.
This is very fast.
Gwendolyn, upon my word.
I'll be coming to you back for something very similar to him, so we're ready.
Gwendolyn, I don't think I can allow something like that one. My couch in front of me.
You always thought you had it strictly in world courts. I do not quite know enough to do that yet.
Thank you. Your guardian enjoys the best in health and his gravity of demeanor is especially to be commended in one so young as he is. You know, I know of no one with a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that's why he often looks a little bored when the three of us are together.
Cecily, I'm surprised at you. Mr. Worthy has had many troubles in life. Out of merriment and triviality are no use in this conversation. And you must remember that his anxiety about that unfortunate young man's brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would allow that unfortunate young man, his brother, to come down and visit us sometimes. We might have a good influence over him. Oh, I'm sure you certainly would, Miss Prism. You know German and geology and things of that kind influence a man very much.
Well, I don't think that even I could produce any effect on the character, according to his own brother, who irretrievably weak and vacillating. Indeed, I do not think I would wish to reclaim him. I'm not in favor of this modern mania for turning bad people into good people at a moment's notice. As a man sows, so shall he live. Cecily, you must put away your diary. You know, I really don't see why you keep the diary at all.
I keep a diary in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I should probably forget all about them.
Your memory, my dear Cecily, the diary that we all carry about.
Yes, but it usually chronicles the things that have never happened and couldn't possibly have happened. Why, I believe memory is responsible for nearly all of the three volume novels that Moody sends us.
Do not speak slightingly of the three volume novels, Cecily.
No, I wrote one myself in early age. Oh, did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are. I hope it did not end happily. I don't like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
Well, the good ending happily and the bad one happily. You know, that is what fiction means.
I suppose so, but it seems rather unfair. And was your novel ever published?
No, the manuscript was unfortunately misplaced. I used the term in a sense of lost or mislaid. To your work, child. These speculations are prosperous.
God, I see dear Dr. Charles will come in after the gardens.
Oh.
How are we disappointed, Miss Prism? You are right, Miss Prism.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her so much good to have a short stroll with you in the park, Dr. Chancellor.
Yes, I haven't mentioned anything about her headache.
No, dear Miss Prism, I know that. I felt instinctively that you had a headache, and I was thinking about just that and not my German lesson.
I hope you are not inattentive.
Oh, I'm afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be this present teacher, how I would handle my relatives. I spoke perfectly. My metaphor is strong beliefs. Mr. Worthy, I suppose, has he returned without me?
Oh, no, no.
We
did not expect him to Monday afternoon.
Ah, yes. He usually likes to spend his Sundays in Philadelphia. He is not one who so hates enjoyment, as by all accounts that unfortunate young man, his brother, something. But I must not disturb the jury and her people any longer.
My name is Letitia, Doctor.
A classical name, John Jacob Hamilton. Well, I shall no doubt see you both in that church.
You know what, actually, Doctor, I think that I will have a stroll with you until I find out you have a
Sure, it was very pleasant.
Not as pleasant as being here with you.
Well, I don't understand how you can hear it all. Uncle Jack will be back till Monday afternoon.
Yeah, about that. I actually have to leave early Monday. Got an important business engagement that I'm anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but in Philadelphia?
It's in Philly.
Oh, well, of course I understand the importance of not to keeping a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of the beauty of life. However, I really think you'd better wait until Uncle Jack comes back. I'm sure he's going to want to talk to you about your emigrating.
My what?
Your emigrating. Uncle Jack's sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'd rather shoot myself.
Well, Uncle Jack said at dinner on Wednesday night that you'd have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Judging from the accounts I've heard, the next world, Australia. I think this world's good enough for me.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
I'm afraid I'm not that,
Cecily. That's actually why I'm here. I was thinking maybe you could make me permission to inform me.
I'm afraid I have no time this afternoon.
Maybe I could reform myself this afternoon.
Well, it would be rather heroic of you, but I think you should try.
I'm feeling better already.
You're looking a little worse.
I'm hungry.
Oh, how thoughtless of me! I should have remembered that when one is leading an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come in?
I would love to. Might I have a root beer first? I never have an appetite unless I have a root beer first.
A red rose?
I'd rather have a pink one.
Why?
If you, Cousin Cecily, would like a pink rose.
You can't be right for you to say such things to me. This prison never talks to me like that.
No, but the prison is a blind old hag. You're the most beautiful woman I've ever seen.
This prison says that good looks are a snare.
Yeah, snare and a sensible man would love to be trapped in.
I don't think I should like to catch myself a sensible man. I wouldn't know what to talk to him about.
Manager at the hotel room.
some slight allusion to the tragic domestic affliction next Sunday? My sermon on the meaning and the manner can be adapted to almost any occasion, joyful or as in the present case. It's Christmas. I have Christmas, harvest celebration, Christmas, Cave of Illumination. The last time I was here was at the cathedral. The bishop that was there was much struck by some of the advertising.
So, Dr. Charles, will you mention christenings? I suppose you know how to christen well.
Well, it is, I regret to say, one of the rector's most constant duties in this parish. You know, I spoke with the four of last time I had it, but they don't seem to know what thrift is.
What? Is that anything wrong? Anything?
Your brother was unmarried.
Unmarried? Was he?
Yes, he was unmarried.
People who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
But this christening is for a baby. I am very fond of children, but, well, I was wondering if we're all right with you, if I could be christened this afternoon.
What? I suppose you have been christened already.
I have no memory of it.
But have you any grave thoughts on the subject?
I certainly intend to. I don't know if it bothers you at all, my being too old now.
Not at all. Sprinkling is indeed immersion. It's indeed a phenomenal
immersion?
Sprinkling is all that is necessary. And indeed, I think it was. But I must get going. I must not stay in the house of sorrow any longer. And always remember, what seems to us great doubts are often blessings in disguise.
Well, this seems to me a lesson of an extremely obvious.
Thank you.
Actually, the diary.
I did.
No, you see.
love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, and hopelessly.
I don't think you should say you love me wildly, passionately, devotedly.
Hopelessly.
Hopelessly doesn't seem to make much sense now, does it?
The taxi is at the doorstep.
Don't come around. Say hi. That's me.
Thanks. Yes, sir.
I might respect you, Ernest, and I might admire your character, but I don't think I could ever give you my understanding.
I have a very important engagement to make with him. And yeah, we're on track now.
Seeing as we've been engaged since February the 14th, and I only just met you today, don't you think it's a little long to be away for half an hour? Couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back before you can say that was wrong.
What an impetuous boy he is. I like his hair so much. I should enter his proposal in my diary.
Miss Fairfax has called. I'm going to visit this evening. You must have seen Mr. Worthing at once.
Isn't Mr. Worthing in his library?
Mr. Worthing tripped over to the rectory some time ago.
Have Miss Fairfax come here and bring tea.
Yes, yes.
Miss Fairfax must be one of the many elderly women associated with Uncle Jack in the city in the philanthropic work. I don't particularly like women who are interested in philanthropic work. I think it is so forward of them.
Miss Fairfax.
Even though incident? How dare you! This is not the time to be wearing the shallow mask of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade!
Well, I'm glad to say that I have never seen a spade, but it is very obvious that our social spheres have been widely different.
Earnest!
experienced in anything of this sort, but I have no brother Ernest. I have no brother at all. I have never had a brother, and I never intend on having a brother.
I do not refuse is food and drink.
and muffins.
Algernon! I wish to see you go.
Go? I couldn't possibly leave before I can dinner first. I mean, only vegans and vegetarians and people like that
leave before you.
Besides,
chill was not hereditary.
Oh, it used to be, but science, it's a beautiful, wonderful thing, constantly evolving and changing. There's no reason to think it isn't hereditary now.
That is nonsense! You never speak anything but nonsense.
Nobody ever does.
Chat the muffins again.
I wish you got some. Thousand videos of you. Is there something you don't like in your own house? acting keys elsewhere at the present. Bunbury's dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die?
I killed him this afternoon. He died.
Oh!
house under the false pretense of being my mother. Under an assumed name he drank, I have just been informed, an entire pint bottle of my favorite wine. I was preserving that wine for myself, and consequently, he seemed to continue in the afternoon to alienate the affections of my only ward. He subsequently stayed for tea and devoured every single muffin. What makes his conduct all the more heartless is the fact that he knew from the beginning that I have no brother. I have never had a brother, and I never intend on having a brother. I know this because I told him so distinctly myself yesterday afternoon.
Well, Mr. Worthy, after very careful consideration, I have decided to entirely overlook my nephew's conduct towards you.
That's very generous of you, Mrs. Bracknell. But I'm afraid that my own view on the subject is unchanged.
Sweet Cecily, how old are you, dear? Well, I'm really 18, but I always admit to 20 at evening parties. And you are right in doing so. A woman should never be too accurate about her age. It looks so calculated. 18, but admit 20 at dinner parties. Well, it's not long before you are free of the restraints of tutelage. So I don't see why the consent of your guardian is a matter of any importance.
If I may interrupt once again, Mrs. Bracknell, as per Mr. Thomas Cardew's will, Miss Cardew does not come of age. So she is 35.
That does not seem to be a very good thing. 35 is a very attractive age. There are plenty of women in Philadelphia who have, by their own free choice, remained 35 for years. Take Miss Dumpton, for instance. She's been 35 ever since she arrived at the age of 40, which was many, many years ago. I do not see why Miss Cecily should be any more attractive at 35 than she is right now.
Algie?
Yeah?
Do you think you could wait for me until I was 35?
Cecily, wait for me forever.
Well, I can't. See, I can't even wait 5 minutes for anybody. And I don't know how I'd wait that long to be married.
What are you supposed to do?
I don't know.
Mr. Worthy, as Miss Cardew has just stated that she cannot wait until she is 35, an objection that seems to show a somewhat impatient nature, I would beg of you to reconsider your decision.
But Mrs. Breck, the matter is entirely in your own hands. All you need to do is consent to my marriage with Wendell, and I will gladly give my consent to the union of my ward and your nephew.
Worthy, you must understand that what you are proposing is entirely out of the question.
Then passionate celibacy is all that awaits any of us.
That is not the destiny I propose for my Gwendolyn. Come here. We have already missed 5, if not 6 trades. To miss any more might expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is quite ready for this.
The precedence? Is that not somewhat premature?
These two men had the immediate desire for baptism.
Baptism? At their age, the idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. Your uncle would be highly displeased if he learned that was the way he was spending your money.
I want to hear that there will be no christening tonight for you.
No, I don't think that it would be of much practical value to either of us.
I am afraid to hear such sentiments from you. They savor the relief that our very belief has left us. Belief that I am completely relieved
they don't. I have just been informed by the people that this prison has been waiting for me for the past hour and a half in the vegetable.
Repellent aspect, remotely connected with education.
Well, she is one of those cultivated beings in the
in some sort of error. There is the woman who can tell you who you really are.
What?
Mrs. Brackman, will you kindly inform me who I am?
Well, I'm afraid that the news I have to give you will not altogether please you. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrief. Consequently, Elgie's elder brother.
Elgie's elder brother? General Ernest John. I always knew that my name was Ernest. I mean, naturally, it's Ernest.
I do remember that the general's name was